Well, welcome to week number one of a series we're calling By My Spirit. Everyone say, By My Spirit. By My Spirit, amen? And so in this four-week series, we're really going to begin to understand the value and the importance of the Holy Spirit in our lives. And most of us would probably say, if we've been around church, all right, well, we know the Holy Spirit's valuable. We know He's important in our lives. But I want to talk about some things over this series that I think will really help us in the days ahead. And so I want to ask you this. Do you ever feel like you're doing everything you can to follow God, to get the victory over sin, to live for Jesus? Anybody ever feel like you're doing everything you can and you still fall short? I think most of us would say, yeah, that's us. And you know, we're not alone. How do we typically respond when that happens? Well, we're going to give it a little extra effort. We're going to be more self-disciplined. We're going to lean in more firmly, right? We're just going to gut it out. We're just going to make it happen, right? And then still what happens? We fall short. So, which is why this series is really important. Because we cannot do it in our own strength. We cannot live for God the way He wants in our own strength. In the Old Testament, the prophet Zechariah was sent to encourage God's people. They had been in captivity in Babylon. A few of them had come back and they'd started to rebuild the altar area, the temple. And after a little while, they just got tired. You ever get tired? You ever get worn out? I mean, this kind of weather we've been having, you walk outside for about 0.3 seconds, you're like, oh, I'm done. Right? And I don't know if that's what days were like for them, but it was tough. And so in that season, Zechariah received a visitation from an angel. And so here's what it says in Zechariah 4:1. Then the angel who had been talking with me returned and woke me up as though I had been asleep. What do you see now? He asked. I answered, I see a solid gold lampstand with a bowl of oil on top of it. Around the bowl were seven lamps, each one having seven spouts with wicks. And I see two olive trees, one on each side of the bowl. Then I asked the angel, what are these, my Lord? What do they mean? And then the angel said in verse 5, don't you know? The angel asked. No, my Lord, I replied. Then he said to me, this is what the Lord says to Zerubbabel. It is not by force nor by strength, King James, not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of heaven's armies. Turn to somebody and say, it's not by might, not by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord. Tell them that. Amen. Now the lamp here represents the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is also represented in the oil. Oil is a symbol of the Holy Spirit in the Bible. And so just like, you know, if you got a squeaky bearing or something on a machine, you need to add some oil. It just makes it work better. The same is the Holy Spirit in our lives. And so Jesus, in fact, tells us the same thing in the New Testament. After His death, burial, and resurrection, He tells His disciples, hey, you're going to need something more to do what I've called you to do. In Luke 24:49, He says, now I will send the Holy Spirit just as the Father promised. But stay here in the city until the Holy Spirit comes and fills you with power from where? Heaven. We don't need earthly power. We need heavenly power. And He was saying, you need my power before you can fulfill my assignments. That's not in my notes, and I hadn't planned to say it and didn't have the thought to write now, but the Holy Spirit just quickened something to me. And here's what I want you to say. The Holy Spirit is not just for you to get through your life. The Holy Spirit is for you to do what His assignment is in your life. So let me just, I know we've got guests, I know we've got experienced people in the Lord, but if you're just playing church to get your life a little better, you're missing out. That's what I would call Christianity survival mode. Where God wants us to be is living by His Spirit so we can accomplish those things for the kingdom of God that He's assigned us to fulfill. And that's why every one of us have an assignment from God. Good place to say amen, but I'll preach to myself if y'all are not going to listen today. Amen. My pastor used to say, if you're rubbing the cat's fur the wrong way, let the cat turn around. So I'm kind of in a cat turnaround mode today. Are y'all okay with that? I'll turn to somebody and say, turn around. Amen. He's just not trying to get you through Monday. He's trying to do a work in you so you get involved in what the kingdom of God is about. Amen? I need to stop preaching and just keep going here. All right? So he said, I'm going to fill you with power. You need this power. In fact, before Jesus ascended into heaven, he said this in Acts 1:4. Once when he was eating with them, he commanded them, do not leave Jerusalem until the Father sends you the gift he promised, as I told you before. You ever notice this when somebody tells you multiple times, it's really important, okay? Verse 5, John baptized with water, but in just a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Y'all missed it a whole bunch earlier, what, pouring water. John 7, Jesus said the Holy Spirit is like rivers of living water on the inside. Don't you wish you had some? All right. Verse 6, so when the apostles were with Jesus, I want you to underline these words. They kept asking. They kept asking him, Lord, has the time come for you to free Israel and restore our kingdom? So Jesus is over here talking about the Holy Spirit, and they're like, hey, are you going to deal with the Romans? Are you going to set us free? And so they're just distracted. They had their own agenda. So many times in life we can have our own agenda, and we get distracted by that. By the way, the same thing happens today. You need more of the Holy Spirit. You need Holy Spirit. Well, who's in office? Let's get us all fight about that. You know, who's that? We just get angry about everything, right? We got all this stuff going on. Jesus, when are you going to fix them and my family members and that person at work? And when are you going to take care of them, right? Come on, he's saying, well, no, be filled with my Spirit, right? Jesus is saying, when are you going to reach the world for me? That's our job, right? So he replied, the Father alone has the authority to set those dates and times, and they are not for you to know. It was, listen carefully, it was not for them to know when things were going to change in their country. Just like that, it's not for us to know when Jesus will return. We know the season, but we don't know the hour. All right? So this is what you need to know. He is returning. I do believe it will be soon. I mean, how much longer can this continue? Right? Come on, right? And the question is, are you ready? Are you ready, you that are online? Are you ready? Are you living filled with the Holy Spirit? Are you helping others, as many as possible, take steps to have a relationship with Jesus and to grow in their walk with him? If so, you're on track. You don't need to know much more, right, than that. We can't do it by might or my power. It takes by his Spirit. Verse 8, here's what we need. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you, and you will be my witnesses telling people about me everywhere in Jerusalem, throughout Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. We cannot be effective witnesses for Jesus without the Holy Spirit. In fact, it's impossible. But we can't accomplish the mandates God's put on our lives. We can't accomplish the mandates God's put on this church without the power of the Holy Spirit working in and through us. Amen? So let it be said of us like it was of Jesus. I love this verse, Acts 10:38. And you know that God anointed Jesus, right, of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. Then Jesus went around. What did he do? Doing good and healing all who were oppressed of the devil, for God was with him. We need his power every day, every single day. And so the thing is, many times, especially in the era I grew up in, those that were Spirit-filled, turn to somebody and say, Spirit-filled. They would look down on, many of them looked down on those who they didn't consider Spirit-filled. So here's something I want you to remember. It's on the screen. Being filled with the Holy Spirit doesn't make me better than you. It makes me better than me. Amen. Who's your biggest problem? Us, right? So we need the Holy Spirit to empower us to live the way God wants us to. So here's the thing. The Holy Spirit also wants to empower our prayers. And I need y'all to pray for me. My voice is struggling this morning. I'm on the back end of some of the stuff. Others have been fighting. Y'all just stretch out your hands and pray for me. I'm going to cough and drink water. Amen. It's the first day of 21 days of prayer, so we would just well pray, right? That was weak. Okay, I didn't hear y'all praying very loud, so we're going to work on that. Amen? So what do you think of when you think of prayer? If you had asked me when I was a kid, I thought, oh, you know, old people getting up and talking too long and saying things to God in words I didn't understand. Right? Anybody ever felt that way? Like, just stop praying already because he heard you the first time. Right? I would also said it was hard to pray. I would have also said that I'm pretty much done after a few sentences. You ever feel like that, you know? I don't know what else to say. I mean, I said the same thing to you yesterday, right? You know, God just rewind, check yesterday's notes. And I'm not trying to be respectful with God, but we just get these attitudes. My prayer didn't get past the ceiling, right? We've got all this stuff going on. And maybe you felt the same way. And so I found it difficult to engage and just really make prayer part of my life or even to receive much in prayer. Because prayer isn't designed to be a one-way street. It's designed to be two-way communication. God's supposed to be speaking back to us. So I want to talk to you a little bit today about spirit-filled prayer. Now, we don't have time to cover everything. I'm going to skip to some basic things today. But I want you to notice how the early disciples leaned to what I'm going to call the first thing, the priority of prayer. They made prayer a priority. So as soon as Jesus ascended into heaven, the disciples returned to Jerusalem to wait on the Holy Spirit. They knew they needed power. How many of you need more power in your lives? Amen. Are you sure? Yes. All right. You need more power. So how do you get the power of God? So what did they go do? Verse 14 of chapter 1. They all met together and were constantly united in prayer along with Mary, the mother of Jesus, several other women, and the brothers of Jesus. You could call it simple obedience. They were just doing what Jesus said. But I think you could also call it a hunger for more of God. See, sometimes what we think is that the problems that we're facing are just because God's left us and abandoned us, but it's really the enemy trying to destroy you, and what God wants to turn that into is a hunger for more of him. But you got to let that happen, amen? So don't let the challenges keep you from prayer. Let the challenges motivate you to pray, right? Even after they received the Holy Spirit in Acts 2, prayer was one of the things that they know were known for, right? So here's the thing. Prayer should be our first response, not our last resort. So to help make prayer a priority around here, we say pray first. Say that with someone, to someone. Pray first. Pray first. Amen? So on your way out today, you can go by the connection point. We got these little light blue bands that say pray first. Why do we have those? So you can wear those as long as you need to wear them to remind you to pray first, right? And you can do that. And so I encourage you to pick one up. See, if we can worry, we can pray. Because worry is just self-directed prayer, and prayer is God-directed worry. All right? And so you just give that to God. You already got the capability to pray. Just take it to the right direction. Amen? Worry is based on self-dependence. Prayer is based on God-dependence. Amen. Amen? So we have an opportunity to make prayer a priority. And then the second thing is we need to and should have and lean into a plan of prayer. Do you have a prayer plan? Notice Jesus had, his disciples noticed that Jesus had a habit, a lifestyle of prayer. In Luke 11, 1, once Jesus was in a certain place praying, as he finished, one of his disciples came to him and said, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. Jesus said, this is how you should pray. Listen to me very carefully. Jesus did not say, this is the prayer you should pray. Because what some of us do is we just think, well, I'm just going to say the Lord's Prayer. I'm good. Lord already knows the Lord's Prayer. He already knows your thoughts, but he wants you to tell him what you need and have a relation. What he's looking for is a relationship in all of this. So he gives us a plan of prayer. This is one. We don't have time to go into it. We'll have prayer guides for you on Tuesday night. I'll talk about that in a bit. But Matthew 6:9, pray like this. Our Father, doesn't say pray this. It says pray like this. Our Father in heaven, may your name be kept holy. May your kingdom come soon. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So part of our job is to pray what's in heaven onto earth, right? Give us today the food we need. Help us to not hoard toilet paper and other necessities. Oh, that was for last year. Okay. Verse 12. And forgive us our sins as we have forgiven those who sin against us. And don't let us yield to temptation, but rescue us from the evil one. So this is a prayer strategy. And like I said, that prayer strategy we lay out a little bit more in the prayer guide that's online. It's on our 21 Days of Prayer website page and all of that. You can look at that. But here's the thing. If Jesus gives individuals a plan of prayer, don't you think he would probably give a church a plan of prayer? Don't you think a church ought to have a plan of prayer? Well, we do. And so let me talk to you a little bit about that. This is a different way of looking at it than you've ever heard it before. First of all, you have praying pastors. Before we launched a church, we were part of a church that really had a praying pastor. I thought, that's amazing. I don't know how he even does that. But you know what? You just keep walking with God and you'll become the people that you admire in prayer, you'll be a lot more like them in 10 years if you just keep leaning into prayer. So Kim and I, we pray. I'm a morning prayer walker. Kim is a nighttime stalker. She'll be up in the middle of the night walking and praying and just, you know, just taking ground at night. But you got pastors that pray. You know, many of you have come. We prayed for over 2,700 people online in the last 2 years, and many of you are those people, and you're here because we prayed for you. We've also got praying teams. Our team leaders and our teams pray for each other. They pray for you. We pray on Sunday mornings before you even get through those doors. And so you're prayed for. Our prayer team prays over leadership. Their prayer partners up here after service. They pray for you. They pray for the prayer requests that Benita mentioned on the bottom of your connection cards all week long. We got praying groups. All our groups include an element of prayer. And then the best part is this is where it really gets good, when we all pray. Amen? When we all pray. So today is day one of 21 days of prayer. Now I recognize, especially for some of you that are here in the building, some of you online, you may have heard about it but not really leaned into it. Others of you are new and you've not been around here. And so let me just explain what 21 days of prayer is. 21 days of prayer is an all skate. Anybody ever go roller skating? And you're roller skating and then they say, okay, now all the couples and all this group and all that group. And then every once in a while they'll say, it's an all skate. So 21 days of prayer is an all skate. We all going to pray. Turn to somebody and say, we all going to pray. Amen. Here's the thing. The results depend on your participation. But here's what we've seen. We've seen people set free of addictions. We've seen families restored. We've seen people healed. We've seen miracles. All kinds of things have happened during 21 days of prayer. So the question you got to ask yourself is, what has God want for me? What am I willing to pursue for God to do a work in my life? So you also need to know the prayer format. Here's what we're doing over these next 3 weeks, 21 days. Day one ends on August 13th. And so on Monday, Wednesdays, and Friday nights at 7, we're going to have online prayer. It's going to be by Zoom. And so you say, well, I don't know the link. Have you checked your email? Rescue that poor, lonely email from your spam folder. Go ahead and whitelist. Say this is a safe email. And just so you can get those notifications. There's more going out tomorrow before tomorrow night. So you can give us those emails on your connection card. We'll get those in. And make sure you check that box that says new information. But we'll do that Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. And then inside our Facebook group, we're also going to be live in there at the same time. So you can join us online. And then Tuesday and Thursday night at 7, we're going to be in the building. And we'll say in the building. Also at Saturday morning at 9. It's 1 hour. We're not religious about a lot of things, but we're going to end in an hour. You know, we're just going to come together. We're going to do business with God, and we'll let you go about your day or your evening. Amen? So let me give you some quick tips on how to see great progress in the next 21 days. Let me ask you, maybe before we get there, it's July 24th. How's this year going for you? Are you anywhere near where you wanted to be by this time? You have this sense that God has more for you, but you haven't seen it yet? Well, here's some things that'll help you. First of all, I want to just encourage you to set your faith for miracles. I mean, we've tried it by might. We've tried it by power. How about trying it by His Spirit? Amen. Let's just believe God for miracles. You need healing. You need deliverance from addictions. You need answers from God. You need direction in your life. Come on, let's believe God. You're going to know in these 21 days. My team knows, our lead team knows, that typically there's changes that come out of the 21 days because I'm praying about things all 21 days, asking God for confirmation, making adjustments, hearing things from Him, and then we make some adjustments coming out of 21 days. That's what your life ought to look like. You're believing for that miracle, but you know, it gives you some answers that you need to move forward. Here's another thing. Prioritize our prayer times. Prioritize our prayer times. So I can pray anytime I want. Well, sure you can. How's that going for you? Well, I prayed over my food 3 weeks ago. Well, good. But let's do a little better. Amen? We're gonna help you in this. I still walk mornings and pray. Because here's the thing. Do you know what's going to happen in November? October? December? Next year? Neither do I. But I bet it's going to require more prayer than what we got going on right now. You never know what you're going to face. See, when life happens and life comes at you, you can't just say, all right, pause everybody, I got to go pray. You need to live out of an abundance. So there's two seasons a year, January and this time of year, we say, let's just lean in to extra prayer. I don't feel like it. Who does? I can't tell you how many times as your pastor, I thought, you know what, we're going to have 7 days of prayer. That's just a lot of work. But you know what? Every time I get done, I say, oh, thank God we went 21 days. Because God does something. So we're going to lean into our prayer times. Amen? And there's something that happens when we gather. Amen. All right? So we're going to gather. So here's another challenge for you. I want to challenge you to lean into our prayer style. And there's many things that I'll tell you about this. I recognize we all have a style about a lot of things in life. And it can be a preference, but there's a reason why we do things the way we do in 21 days of prayer. And I want you to understand that. So here's the first thing you need to understand. Nobody's going to stand up here and call, especially in the building or even when we're online, nobody's going to just randomly call on you to pray. So you don't have to worry, because what's the greatest fear when you're not comfortable praying? Somebody's going to ask you to pray. Oh, Lord. You know, that'll get your prayer life started right there, right? And then every prayer time, there's going to be a short devotional, okay? And it'll just be a little teaching by a speaker that's going to help you take ground in prayer. And then there's going to be a time when a leader is praying, someone who we've asked to pray, they'll pray. And then there's also going to be time for personal prayer and for worship. And it's the simplest, easiest thing. And so when we're on site, we'll have prayer guides like the one I got here. They'll look like this. Pray first. You could spend your whole 21 days just praying through this. And we'll have those available here on Tuesday night. And then we'll have that devotional. We'll have a time with a leader. And then we're going to have some personal prayer time. And we have worship playing here. You can be crying out to God. You can be on your knees. You can be walking. Whatever. Just a comfortable place to pray. Amen? Amen. Well, and here's what happens. Some of us think, well, I was taught prayer meetings should be... fill in the blank. That's great. Why do we do it the way we do it? Because our purpose is to help people who've never got a healthy prayer life, help them get one started and enjoy it. Amen. Realize they can spend time with Jesus. It's not just about going to God with this list and I got to just tell him what I need, what I need, what I need. I'm done. Okay, I'm out. Some of us need to learn just to sit and soak, just to be in His presence. just to be in an atmosphere where all the other stuff is out. We're just with Jesus. That's what these times together are about. Amen? Amen. And then some of you might think, well, I like to pray differently. Great. Do that on your own time. But when we're together, let's pray in a way that will encourage others. Amen? And then somebody may even say, well, you know what, Pastor? I'm a prayer warrior. Great. Then you should absolutely have no problem making some adjustments so that you can help others enjoy what you love and are called to do. Amen? Amen. Help create that atmosphere in prayer. Here's the thing. There is no room for pride in prayer. At the very bottom of it, we're saying, God, I need you. I'm not enough, but you are. Right? So that should inform our style. Amen? So why all this attention to prayer? Because of the third thing here, the power of prayer. The power of prayer. Just think about it. In the book of Acts, as the believers prayed, miracles happened. As the church prayed together, thousands got saved. As the church prayed together, the religious didn't like it. You figure out which side you're on real quick when there's a prayer gathering, right? And I'm not trying to put any guilt on anybody, but Peter and John, they were persecuted. They were praying, but they were persecuted. They were arrested, and then I don't have time to go into it, but they were released. So let's pick it up in Acts 4:23. As soon as they were freed, Peter and John returned to the other believers and told them what the leading priests and elders had said. When they heard the report, all the believers lifted their voices together in prayer to God, O sovereign Lord, creator of heaven and earth, the sea, and everything in them. I want you to catch something here. When we're praying, we're not just saying words. When we're praying to the Creator, to God Almighty, who still creates. He still does miracles. He still does things in our lives. So we've got to understand that there is great power in prayer. And obviously, there's a lot more we could say about that. But I want to talk about this as we wrap up today. So how do we pray powerful prayers? When you read the book of Acts, there was some powerful praying going on. Things were happening, right? It was great. Here's the first thing. Powerful prayers are unified. Unified. The Bible tells us that when it does not rain and times are hard, sound familiar? Here's what 2 Chronicles 7:14 says. Then if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and restore their land. Do you belong to Jesus? Then you're called to pray. It's part of who you are. Whether you're young, whether you're old, and everybody in between, we are called to pray. And when we pray as a people, when we humble ourselves and we repent. By the way, humbling yourself is different than being humbled by life. I remember years ago being in a prayer gathering with some pastors, and one of the pastors said, hey, we really need to pray about this. And the other guy said, has it come to that? Sounds terrible, indictment on pastors, but most of us act that way. We're going to do our might do our power, and then if it doesn't work out, then we're going to cry out to God. Let's do it the opposite. Let's prioritize prayer. Let's lean into prayer. Let's have something in the tank. Amen. And let's pray with that humility that, God, we need you. And then if God shows us something that's not right, let's be willing. He calls it wicked here. Let's repent. Let's change. Amen. You can't even do that by yourself. I can't either. We need the Holy Spirit to do that. Amen. So we pray like that. God will hear. He'll answer. Jesus said, in Matthew 18:18-19, I tell you the truth, whatever you forbid on earth will be forbidden in heaven, and whatever you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven. Also tell you this, if two of you agree here on earth concerning anything you ask, my Father will do it for you. I want to just say to couples, married couples, husbands and wives, pray with your spouse. Get in agreement on things. Kim and I call it getting in agreement. Because you can get in disagreement. She's praying for this and you're praying for that. And God says, well, they're one. I don't know which one to take. So we're going to pray in agreement. What are you believing for? What are you doing? You pray in agreement. You find that scripture and you say, well, I'm single. Find another friend. And you just get in agreement on those things because there's power in agreement. He said he'll do it for you. For where two or three gather together as my followers, I am there among them. Now, just because God is there with just a few doesn't mean that you're not missing out when you're not a part of the few. Did you get that? Amen? So we're going to participate. Amen? So I just want to challenge you, make as many of the prayer gatherings as possible, whether it's online or in person. Amen? Just get here. Be here for as many. And here's my challenge. We just came out of a 7-week summer semester of small groups, and they were awesome. And on Tuesday nights, the women met up here, and there was a whole bunch of you women that were up here, and you loved it. So here's my challenge. On Tuesday nights, women, make sure you're here. And then on Thursday nights, the men gathered, and we had a great time together. And so my challenge is on Thursday night, men, make sure you get here. Let's just stay. You already cleared that night anyway. Let's do it in prayer. Amen. Let's just keep it going. Keep it flowing and just make prayer a priority. You say, well, I need a friend. I'm looking to meet somebody. Yeah, well, Jesus said, no, he didn't, but he's our friend. I was going to say, you have a friend in me. He never said that. That was in a movie. But John 15 says, he called the disciples, you're my friends. So let's go hang out with Jesus for 21 days. Amen. Amen. All right, I'm preaching better than you're shouting, so that's all right. So we just get in unity. With 21 days, we're gonna gather on these times. So prayer, powerful prayers are not only unified. Number two, they're scriptural. Look at this verse in Acts 24, the next verse, continuing the prayer we read earlier. They said, you spoke long ago by the Holy Spirit through our ancestor David, your servant, saying, why were the nations so angry? Why did they waste their time with futile plans? You know what they're doing? They're praying from Psalms chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. That was the scripture they had. We've got the full scriptures with the New Testament, so the believers prayed the scriptures. Why did they do that? 2 Corinthians 1:20. For all of God's promises have been fulfilled in Christ with a resounding yes, and through Christ our amen, which means yes, ascends to God for his glory. So if God's already promised it in the Bible, when we pray it, we're getting our lives lined up with what God's already promised to give us. Amen? It's so awesome. It's a wonderful thing. In fact, scriptural prayer is prophecy to our future. You want God to do something in your future? Find it in the scripture and start praying it over your life. Start declaring it over your life. And you watch what God does. And here's the third thing about powerful prayers. Powerful prayers are bold. Everyone say bold. Continuing that prayer in Acts 4, verse 29. And now, O Lord, hear their threats and give us, your servants, great boldness in preaching your word. And what are you thinking? I don't want to preach. But every one of us preach every day. I just use more words on Sunday. Your life is preaching to somebody. What's the message being sent? Verse 30, stretch out your hand with healing power. May miraculous signs and wonders be done through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. They not only prayed for boldness, they prayed boldly. Okay? And so we can ask for great things for the good of others. Do you know some people that need healing in their lives? You know some people that need addictions broken off? Do you know somebody that needs a financial miracle? You know someone that needs a marriage healed, a family restored? How about we pray for them during 21 days of prayer? And if you just keep your eyes and ears open, that'll fill an hour right there. I mean, there's just enough people to pray over. Amen? And so the next verse, 31, says, after this prayer, the meeting place shook, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit. This is after the first time. Then they preached the word of God with boldness. Here's what that boldness looked like. That boldness, it basically was they left the prayer meeting with such belief that they acted on their prayers. So they said, God, give us boldness. And then they acted like it was going to come true, and they just went out and preached boldly, and the Holy Spirit gave them the power to do it. Amen? So when you pray, sometimes you pray, oh, this is a whole nother message, but sometimes you pray, and you just got to keep praying until you get to that point, you have that confidence from God. How about the building shaking would give you some confidence? That's what they had. It may not look like that for you, but you can walk out of there with confidence. Amen? Now, so too often, though, we may be timid in prayer. We even shy away from prayer. Why is that? We're worried that maybe God won't come through for us. What if he doesn't answer? What if, maybe we think our standing with God isn't so good. You know, he'll listen to those leaders and, you know, he'll listen to pastor, but I'm just me. Now, you have as much standing with God as I. I'm just in a different responsibility than you are. I have a different role, but we're all called. Amen? We all can have right standing with God. Another thing that might keep us from prayer is not being clear on God's will. That's part of what I use 21 days for. There's things I pray over every day. We have 21 days prayer targets that you can pray over on our website. But maybe you get some things and say, God, I need clarity on this. I'm going to pray over this during these 21 days. It'll give you confidence. Amen? Maybe you don't pray much because of your own short sins and shortcomings. Repent. Turn away from it. Amen? Say, God, I'd rather have you than that. And here's the promise. James 5:16. The earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power and produces wonderful results. We're not righteous by our own perfection. We're righteous by the grace of God. We just simply receive it by faith. Amen? Amen. So our prayers can have great power and produce wonderful results. I'm going to do something a little different here, but I want you to just lean into this with me as we close here this morning. We're actually going to pray. You say, Pastor, I've never been to church to pray so much in the middle of a service. Anyway, well, we're going to pray together. Amen? And you can sit, you can stand, you can do it however you need to do it. And we're not going to pray an hour. This is going to be real short. But we're going to pray some powerful scriptural prayers. Worship team's going to come down. They're going to play a little music here and just be playing under us and behind us. So let's bow our heads and let's go to the Lord. I want to read you a prayer, and then we're going to pray it. It'll be on the screen if you want to look, but I encourage you just to listen. And then I encourage you to use your voice and pray out loud. Some of us are afraid of our own voice in prayer. And if we just all pray, nobody's going to listen to anybody else. We just get to pray it out loud together. Amen. 1 Chronicles 4:10, we call it the prayer of Jabez. The Bible says he was the one who prayed to the God of Israel, O Lord, that you would bless me and expand my territory. Please be with me in all that I do and keep me from all trouble and pain. And God granted him his request. Let's pray that together today. Father, we come to you today. You just pray to God. You can pray out loud. It's okay. If you're comfortable, you can do that. Father, we just ask you today, Lord, that you would bless us. You have blessed us, God, but we need your blessing. Father, there's things that we cannot do by might. There's things that we cannot do by power. Our strength is not enough. And God, today we need you. We need your hand. We need your spirit to work in us and in those areas. Father, we ask you today that you will be with us in all that we do. Father, your word says, Jabez didn't know this, but your word says that you promise never leave us nor forsake us. There in Hebrews 13. Father, we thank you that you're with us. Father, if we knew you today, we brought you here this morning when we came in. So, Father, I thank you that you are with us. Father, just help us to recognize your presence in all that we do in Jesus' name. Father, we pray that you would keep us from trouble and pain. Father, particularly those that we cause ourselves. Father, help us not to do things to make it worse for ourselves. Help us to do it your way, to trust you in the hard times, to be confident in you in the difficult times. Father, to know that you still love us and you still care for us in those times when you seem silent. But Father, we just thank you that you're working in our lives today. Now you just pray. You just pray. Just keep praying. Come on. Just, you don't have to be loud, but just be steady in prayer right here for a moment. Let's do one more. Father, your word tells us in Philippians 4, 4 through 7, to always be joyful and full of the Lord. Father, we need your joy today. Father, joy is not the result of circumstances, it's the result of your presence. So Lord, we need more of you today. As a church, as a people, we cry out to you, God, we need more of you. Give us your joy today. Give us your peace. Father, you said it again here in your word. I say again, rejoice. Father, help us to be considerate in all we do. In a world that's harsh, in a world that's vindictive and retaliatory, help us to be considerate, Lord. Lord, let us remember you're coming soon. This present earth's assignment is not going to last that long in comparison to eternity. It's just a dot on an endless line. And so, Father, I just thank you that you help us in this time. Father, you said here, don't worry about anything. Pray about everything. Father, I thank you there's nothing that you're not uncomfortable hearing. We can tell you everything. Father, I thank you that we'll be bold in these 21 days to tell you what we need. Lord, we need more of you. Father, I thank you that we can praise you for all that you've done. And Lord, in the middle of all that, we just get to experience your peace. Father, I pray for your peace over the people here this morning, for those that are online with us today. Lord, I just thank you for that peace which exceeds anything we can understand. That, Father, your peace guards our hearts and our minds through Christ Jesus. Father, I pray too during these 21 days that people that have been uncomfortable, lacking confidence in prayer, will discover the rich power of connecting with you every single day. Connecting with you in the good times and in the hard times and throughout that day. Father, we ask for that. Father, for those that are online with us today, Father, let them experience that as well. Father, heal their bodies in Jesus' name. Father, we thank you for your goodness in our lives. Pray for your blessings over each one today. In Jesus' name, with every head bowed, every eye closed, maybe you're sitting here today and you just say, you know, Pastor, that's all well and good, but I really don't have a relationship with Jesus this morning. I'm not right with God. I'm just kind of been doing my own thing. Or maybe you kind of came to a place where you gave your life to God, but you walked away from some things. Or maybe life is so hard right now, you know you have a relationship with God, but he just feels far away. This will be a day just to say, God, I come. I surrender to you again. This is the way we're going to do it. I'm going to ask you here in just a moment that if you want to get in on this prayer, you want to give your life to Jesus, that you would simply slip a hand up. Nobody looking around. Everybody's eyes closed. Say, Pastor, I want to pray this prayer. I need to get my life right with God. Hold your hand up. Hold your hand up. I see those hands. Thank you for that. Thank you for that. Thank you for that. You're not telling me. You're telling God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. You can put those hands down. Now let's all say this with those that want to get right with God. Say this with them. Say, Heavenly Father, we come to you today. We ask you to forgive us of our sins, to make us a new person from the inside out. God, we turn away from that old life and we turn to you. God, we surrender to you. Father, we thank you for raising Jesus from the dead. Say it loud. Father, we thank you that you sent Jesus to die on the cross, but you didn't leave him there. So Jesus today, say it with me. So Jesus today, I give you my life. Be my Lord. Be my Savior. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, can you celebrate with that?